We're going to start with Professor Dr. Urs Gasser, who is the Executive Director of the Berkman Klein Center for Internet and Society, also a professor of practice at Harvard Law School, who's come all the way just for one day to be here with us. Thank you so much. So we'll have you kick off, and then we'll have the other two speakers after you. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Malavika. So actually, if you don't mind, since I already had airtime and we're running short in time, I was wondering whether my colleagues would like to start sharing their comments, and I'm then happy to respond and reflect on your comments just because I already had my 15 minutes. So is that okay for you guys?
Yeah, that's okay. Do I start then? Right. Thanks. My name is Keechang. Kim, I teach contract law, what we call civil law, meaning continental European civil law, as opposed to common law. And I also teach Roman law. Now, today I would like to focus on a very narrowly defined area of legal issues relating to autonomous vehicles. Thank God I don't have to talk about all these ethical issues, just focus on legal issues. I see that there are quite a lot of discussions regarding product liability in connection with the autonomous vehicles. But in my view, that approach is not going to work. To cut the long story short, because the notion of defect is really at the core of this product liability regime. And lack of defect does not mean perfection. So when we talk about autonomous vehicles, we can at least envisage two situations. One, where the autonomous vehicle is in fact defective. Defective meaning judging from the prevalent standard of technology or expectations, that particular model or that particular item falls short of that expected level. Yes, in that case, yes, we can talk about defect and we can talk about product liability. And for that discussion, I don't think there is anything new. If some product or some model falls short of the expected level of safety and thus causes injury or death, yes, we can talk about product liability. But autonomous vehicle poses an issue which is very different. That is a model or a particular item which perfectly meets the prevalent expectation or level of technology, nevertheless causes injury or harm or damage. That question cannot adequately be dealt with by resorting to product liability regime, because we do accept that even a very satisfactory level of technical perfection, not perfection, but the level which we can practically attain, can nevertheless cause accidents. So that is something which cannot be dealt with product liability. So we need to come up with a different legal rules to deal with. Second question or point I want to talk about is this notion of negligence, which is often very closely associated with the question of liability. Under the traditional rule, liability can be attributed to a party who is either deliberately caused harm or negligently caused harm. So the question is whether we can talk about deliberate harming or negligent harming. In the case of negligence, I don't think we can talk about negligence in connection with artificial intelligence, because in my view, humans make mistake, but machines don't make mistake. Machines just operate as they are programmed, and we cannot envisage a situation where machine can be described as being negligent. If machine performs in an unsatisfactory manner, then it can be attributed to coding errors or communication errors or some other errors, but machine just operates as it's intended to operate. So there is very little room to talk about the notion of negligence. Another point regarding liability is whether we should describe the question of legal responsibility with respect to decision-making power or the ability to pay damages. If we focus on decision as the key hinging point, then perhaps, yes, artificial intelligence or autonomous vehicle makes decision. So it may appear that we can attribute legal responsibility for erroneous decisions or bad decisions or wrong decisions. But I don't think decision-based notion of liability can resolve the problem of autonomous vehicles, because ultimately we have to talk about whether we can demand payment of damage. If we are going to impose liability, civil lawyers or contract law or tort law lawyers' approach is that once a party is shown to be liable, then that party has to pay damage. But artificial intelligence or autonomous vehicle cannot own assets. So it from the lawyer's point of view, it does not make much sense to talk in terms of decisions. I think when we talk about legal liability, we have to take into account whether the entity or the party is capable of paying damages. In order to do so, we have to talk about whether AI or autonomous vehicle can own assets. And I don't think that is plausible within the foreseeable future. So my final point regarding legal issues concerning autonomous vehicle is to go back in time a little bit. I will just finish in 2 minutes. Go back about a little over 2,500 years. In Roman law, they had a legal system dealing with the question of accidents, death, injury, and then payment of damage, which involves slaves. Now, slaves are making decisions. Slaves do carry out a lot of useful functions, including transport, whatever. But they don't own any assets. They are incapable of paying damages. And I think Roman law rules regarding slavery and questions of legal liability involving slaves and those who either own slaves or possess slaves through lease. You can lease slaves or you can own slaves. But, yeah, you can rent slave for a year or so. But the party who operates slaves are held liable. And I think that rule can have enormous potential in solving problems relating to autonomous vehicle and legal responsibility. One, well, there are many, many passages in Roman law sources dealing with accidents involving slaves operating donkeys. Sorry to talk about donkey transport in connection with artificial intelligence, but in one passage, a slave was doing its best to control the donkey, but the donkey was a bit too stubborn and too powerful so that the slave could not effectively control the donkey, and then the donkey crashed into a pedestrian and then killed the pedestrian. And the Roman lawyers held that even if the slave in question did everything he could in his power to control, but he could not be in control of the situation, and that does not mean that the slave operator, in that case it was an owner, that does not mean that the slave owner is not liable. You should not allow a slave who is either too weak or too inexperienced to control the donkey effectively, and then, as a result, a person is injured, so the slave operator should be held liable. And I think that kind of rule can be very effectively applied even under the existing legal regime in Korea, for example. There is a statute aimed to ensure effective compensation for vehicle-related accidents. And we have these two important concepts. One is vehicle operator, and the other is driver. And obviously, there is third category, passenger. I don't think the concept of passenger is useful, but driver is not the party who is held liable, but the operator is the party who is held liable under the statute. And I think this notion of operator can be fruitfully explored to deal with the questions of legal compensation regarding the autonomous vehicles. So those are my very preliminary and very incomplete thoughts. Thanks.
Thank you so much. Next, we'll have Professor K.S. Park from Korea University Law School and founder of OpenNet Korea.
Professor Kim just mentioned that AI owning assets is not plausible within the near future. So I think I'm going to talk about the implausible future. Well, we have to face that question. So a typical question goes like this. If robots or artificial intelligence makes a mistake, should AI be held responsible? Or should the programmer be held responsible? If you look at how autonomous vehicles are programmed right now, obviously the programmers will be held responsible. For instance, the programmers of Mercedes-Benz, they already made the decision that if the car has to come to a sudden stop to avoid hitting a passenger, they'll program so that the car just has to move forward to save the driver at the expense of hitting a pedestrian. For those decisions that programmers hard coded into the software of the autonomous vehicles, for those decisions, the programmers will be responsible. But what if we have a truly autonomous vehicle that is equivalent to a human driver plus car put together, that are truly autonomous, that update itself, that do not take decisions, and that update its own software. Humans don't need the programmers to update their knowledge. They update you know, their knowledge and skills themselves. And we can certainly think of a point where software becomes capable of doing that. So when the software reaches that point, the point of being able to update itself, you know, shall we hold the software itself or AI or robot run on such software hold responsible? And as Professor Kim already mentioned, the other side of the coin, so when you raise a question, shall we hold something responsible? The other side of the coin of that question is, what does it mean to hold something responsible? If it's civil liability, it means taking away money. If it's criminal liability, it's about taking away freedom. So the question intertwined with you know, the question of whether to hold responsible is whether we will give them any money or freedom to take away. So we are back to this you know, seemingly implausible question of whether we should recognize robots as agents capable of owning assets or owning freedom, which pushes us to a more implausible sounding question of whether robots should be rights, should be given rights, should be recognized, should be given like human-like status so that they have rights. Yes, when I first studied, I thought that, you know, people talking about robot rights were loonies. I thought they were just out in the ethical, out in the fringes. But if you want to think about the practical question of holding, or practical question of distributing liability, even for autonomous vehicles, to at least some part of the responsibility to the vehicles or the robots, then we have to come to the question of whether we should recognize or when we will recognize robots like human beings. Then if we give something rights, where do those rights come from, right? Is it value of human life? Is it free will? Then we have to question, do we even have a free will? I mean, human beings themselves don't know whether we have free will. You know, the 2000-year-old philosophical question, conflict between free will and determinism has still not been solved. If you look at animals, do they have a free will, right? How about babies? Do babies have free will, or are their behavior predetermined by, you know, hormonal circulations? Apparently, we recognize a lot of rights of babies, but we don't recognize a lot of rights of animals. Why do we do that? I mean, where does the difference come from? Oh, okay. Now I see why people are looking at the PowerPoint. I'm going totally out of order. Those were just for the notes for the interpreter.
Sorry.
Yeah. You know, we should go back to these metaphysical questions of why we or where we draw human rights from, or whatever rights that we recognize in human beings. And it is really a metaphysical question that we cannot really resolve. So I think that we have to work back from the facts instead of trying to deduce where the value comes from. We have to come back from what we know about human nature. And I think there are some minimums there are some minimum requirements for granting human-like status to intelligent beings, and I'm going to talk about three minimums. One, I think, is self-preservation. Self-preservation in adverse environment. Self-preservation with the limited resources and possibly with the limited lifetime. You all know about Microsoft chatbot Tay, and it has failed by human standard. But probably it was it failed because it was not given full self-preservative instinct. Probably it was programmed only to be a popular Twitterian. So probably it surveyed, how to get many RTs, how to get many followers, and it copied after other Twitterians, getting a lot of followers, a lot of RTs. But what if it was given a broader self-preservative instinct of becoming a popular person? Would it have made all those racist and sexist jokes if chatbot Tay was asked not just to live within the within the Twitter space, but come out of a cyberspace and actually interact with real human beings outside Twitter? I think that if it was given more broad, more fundamental self-preservative instincts, I think chatbot Tay would have done better. For instance, if it was to learn that making racist jokes or sexist comments, those comments will be RT'd a lot, but will be actually hated by many people, and that if chatbot Tay was given a broader objective of running for an election and getting elected, it would have been much more careful and much more learned in crafting its tweets. So one requirement of granting some intelligent being a human rights status, I think, is whether that thing is equipped with a sufficiently complex, broad self-preservation instinct. And the other is perception of value. And this is not a new territory for studying criminal lawyers. There is already a pretty complex body of law dealing with when to hold an insane person responsible for his or her act. So Mnuchin rule. Mnuchin, Mnuchin rule is representative of such body of law. So there, Mnuchin rule requires that to hold someone criminally responsible, that person should have two perceptions. One is motory perception of what he is doing. Second, moral perception, meaning being able to perceive the moral value of what he or she is doing. And those moral values are, to recognize human rights, to recognize human-like status on some intelligent things, we should check whether that thing is capable of perceiving value. And perception of value, relies a lot on what what the objectives are, right? What are the objectives of a human being, right? Is it to lead a good life? or is it to really just preserve himself or herself, depending on what philosophical objectives are given to the intelligent things, the way those intelligent things perceive value differ widely. But whatever it is, we need to give those intelligent things ability to perceive value. So that's the second minimum. The third minimum, I think, is independence. Meaning that if the robot's behavior, although it's autonomous within certain limited time frame, if it can be strictly programmed by independent human being, the programmer, then obviously the robots themselves cannot be held responsible. It will be the programmers. So we have to build a robot so that it's not really owned by any human being or company. And we have to build a robot that doesn't rely on a company or another human being for getting electricity or getting connected to the internet. You know, the robot will have to figure that out itself. I mean, it has to, maybe it can, you know, go on Twitter or go on YouTube to make money to buy its own electricity. So that kind of independence is needed before giving human-like status to these things or robots. So my final comment is this. Will we ever build robots that meet at least these three minimum requirements? Self-preservation instinct, the perception of value, material independence. Will we ever build robots that meet those three requirements? I do not think so. I think that the human race will never invest valuable resources into building robots that meet these three requirements. So I think that you know, the future that Professor Kim has described as you know, outside the plausibility, I think is really implausible. I think that the human race will not really take that route for various reasons. I mean, even for the simple reason of not having enough resources. Why will we build more intelligent beings that will compete for limited resources that even human beings don't have, right? So that is my comment.
Thank you so much. Malavika, if you don't mind, I just jump in. Maybe just a few comments. This is a very helpful discussion because how many are non-lawyers in the room? Hands up, the non-lawyers. So there is a significant number of non-lawyers. So let me just, or recovering lawyer. Let me just try to highlight a few things that I've heard that I feel are symptomatic and really illustrative for the current discussion in the legal field. When we think about AI as a new phenomenon. What you've heard actually is two conversations. One conversation is about what happens when a new technology enters society and creates risks and challenges that the law as an institution needs to address. So that's a type of problem that I call first order problems. The case study we've heard from Professor Kim was actually autonomous vehicles, that's the example. The legal problem where the law needs to deal with is a liability, is an accident, and the question who's liable. First order problem. You heard the second part of the conversation, which was what Professor Park was talking about, And that's okay. Leaving aside first order problems, where do we generate, where can we get rules, or where can we derive rules from when we don't know what these first order responses are? These are second order problems. These are the question that we're discussing in the field are, what are meta rules that guide our finding of first order principles and rules? So in Professor Park's move, it was the move towards human rights or to aspects of the rule of law. He even went beyond law and was looking into philosophy as meta norms and meta systems that can help to deal with some of the phenomena we observe. Let's quickly focus on the first one, on the first order problem, and use the autonomous vehicle example again to just use by example or make visible some of the typical lawyer moves that you see. Professor Kim spent some time on analyzing what's new about the autonomous vehicle problem when an accident occurs. That's a typical lawyerly move. And you see also that our standard response as legal scholars, as a legal system, is to try to apply the old rules to the new problem. It was brilliantly put in context here by going back to Roman law. As far back as you can, the oldest rules, and take those and apply them to the new phenomenon. That's the standard behavior of the legal system, for actually also self-preservation reasons. No, it's very meaningful for the legal system to do so. What is interesting about it, and you've gone through that very carefully, that of course that's only the default response, that the legal system tries to apply the old rules to the new phenomenon. But it also understands that there are pressure points, that there are moments where the old rules don't really fit the new problem the law needs to deal with. And in these moments, the legal system has to come up with new solutions, has either to gradually expand, in our case, what liability means, what the criteria are, or replace the current system, here, for instance, product liability, by a completely new way of thinking about the problem altogether. And Professor Kim made these very nuanced distinctions, testing out which of the old rule may serve under the new conditions and where are changes that may ask for new types of doctrines and new types of legal rules. And Professor Park as well. So, for instance, the question of foreseeability or intent, the question of independence and autonomy, the question of responsibility was mentioned. These are areas where the analysis shows, oh, wait a minute, some of these old rule assumptions may not translate into the new context and therefore force us within the legal system to reconsider the approach. So I thought that was a very brilliant kind of case study in how legal system deals and lawyers deal with new technology environments. A second quick observation also applied to these first order responses by the legal system when something new comes up. We tend to focus immediately on risks. The examples were not by coincidence, right, chosen. We tend to focus on risks. But at this, and we try to, or we tend to emphasize law as a constraining force, law that imposes criminal liability, as Professor Park also made reference to, or civil liability, damages, something bad happened. But of course, it's also very important to keep in mind that law has not only a constraining function, but also an enabling function. And I feel that in the discussion about AI and the law, we are currently still in this first phase where we focus a lot on the constraining force of law. But I would encourage all of us to also think about what law can do to enable the good uses and the future development of socially beneficial AI technologies. So that's perhaps just an additional perspective that didn't come up so much yet. Now let's move very quickly and only for 2 minutes to some of the second order problems that Professor Park was talking about. He explored human rights as a concept that would allow us to derive values and project them as we are struggling with new phenomena such as self-autonomous vehicles or robots or whatever the use cases were. I would like to add another dimension, another meta rule, and that's the rule of law. The rule of law, this is a set of general norms that direct how first order law that we just discussed is to be created and implemented. And in my opinion, actually, this is even more interesting from a legal perspective rather than compared to the first order responses by the law. And I see something interesting happening with these meta rules in two respects. First, we are already seeing how artificial intelligence systems are shaping the creation and application of law. Think about smart contracts and automated contracting as creation of law through the machine. Think about predictive policing as an area that has a lot to do with law enforcement and law application of law, where machines and algorithms suddenly start to shape legal practices. Or think about the use of data and analytics in sentencing or probation judgments in social justice. So what is special about it is that many of these decision-making mechanisms are largely, again, intransparent and invisible to the observer or to the individual that is affected by some of these decisions. And here you see an interesting tension with principles related to the rule of law. So the rule of law, for instance, asks that any law is duly authorized. What does that mean if machines are transacting and machines or computers are setting new private arrangements? Another aspect is that laws need to be clear and determined in their meaning. What about the ambiguity that is often built into machine-based judgments? So you see, as far as AI is somehow used to shape the creation and implementation of law, that suddenly we get into interesting second-order questions. The second dimension with respect to second-order problems related here, in my case, the rule of law, has to do with the previous panel. It's very intriguing to consider, as the panelists in the previous panel described, how to incorporate ethics and even maybe law and compliance into the AI systems themselves. But if we do so, if we code law into AI, what are the meta rules for doing so? If we have this very long-standing tradition of having higher level principles, how we create such rules? And that's a fundamental rule of law problem. So in other words, what's the rule of law for AI guardian systems? That, again, just signals kind of some of the questions that we are debating currently in academia, but that may be relevant down the road for all of us. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much. We'll take a few questions for this panel, and actually we're all, at the risk of running slightly late, we're actually going to also take questions for the previous panel, and then we'll break for lunch. So maybe about 15 minutes across both the panels, and then we'll have lunch. So would anyone like to address anything to this panel? Anyone in particular?
Question for Dr. Park. I found it interesting. Excuse me. I found it interesting when you were talking about babies. What rights do babies have? To me, I guess one of the issues is we draw a logical conclusion that babies one day will have human agency. How do you feel that this influences our viewing of robots or automated systems, AI, that one day there's an eventuality, a potential eventuality here? Do you feel that we should, because of this potential eventuality of a singularity, that we should be taking into account and designing systems that create ethical frameworks because of a potential logical conclusion of what they could one day be?
Exactly the opposite. You heard my presentation correctly, but my conclusion is exactly the opposite. I don't think I think that programmers should be should just stop worrying about whether robots will have rights or that robots will be held responsible for things. I think those questions, are foregone conclusions. I don't think the human race will actually invest resources into autonomous, value-perceiving, self-preserving, intelligent things. It's just out of selfishness, they'll just never build that. Yes, you're right. The reason that we recognize a lot of rights for babies is because they have a potentiality of becoming full adults. And I mean, the reason we give a lot of, we grant a lot of value to fetuses, human fetuses, is because of potential personhood. So if the software and robots right now have the potential of fully updating themselves, into human beings, yes, we should take care. But my prediction is that we'll never do that. I think that we'll build a lot of resources into building slaves or soft AI that has very limited functions and objectives. I don't think we'll ever build robots that will have broad objectives. For instance, chatbot Tay, it was never programmed to say, lead a good life. If it was programmed to lead a good life, it would not have made, it would have read all the literature, political, ethical literature, and it would not have made those racist, sexist comments. It was given very, very narrow objective for existence, which was to, being a popular Twitterian.
I just add my side of the comments, although the question was not addressed to me, because I did not give you the full story about the slavery in Roman law. There is a considerable gap between the law or legal rules, especially regarding liabilities and compensation for damage on the one hand, and the reality on the other hand. On the level of law, Roman lawyers never recognized that slaves could own anything. Slaves can never own anything. They can never be held liable in a civil suit. But the reality is different. Slaves did own property. It was not recognized in law, but in reality and from economic perspective, slaves did own assets. Now, although Professor Park quite confidently said that we will never allow machines competing resources with human beings. I'm already poor, and then I don't want to see the era where machines have more money than I have. Yes, but I don't know whether we can really be confident about the future. The question about assets, from lawyers' point of view, we can, until the very end, until the bitter end, we can insist that machines can never own anything, just as Roman lawyers insisted that slaves could never own anything. But in reality, I don't think it's very clear-cut issue. When machines do a lot of transactions, when machines do take care of and make very important economic decisions, then the dividing line between whether it owns or it does not own becomes very blurred. The machine can, in fact, enjoy huge amount of resources, which I, as a human being, cannot even dream of tapping anything, whereas machines do make many decisions, and that decision can benefit it. So just one other episode we must keep in mind is that in Roman law, there were slave rebellions as well. So that might also be some kind of dismal future.
So I published a link to the Berkman Harvard question tool where people can upload questions in real time for anyone. We have one question comment on that, which I'll just read out if anyone from either this panel or the previous one wants to take it, from Sam Chua, which is, it strikes me from this morning that the closest socio-technical analog to AI is the corporation. Limited liability, legal autonomy, delegated agency, inscrutable operations, etc. So a thought experiment, AI boards for governance and accountability. So anybody want to comment on that, the idea of AI boards?
Well, I think that corporations are recognized human-like status and are held responsible. So they are given responsibility and rights, especially exactly because they meet those three requirements that I mentioned. It's not really a surprise. It's really no. I mean, corporations are, you know, have self-preservation instincts because of corporate law. The board members executing the acts of a corporation are required to maximize the interests of the shareholders. So legally, they are programmed to have self-preservation instincts, and they have material independence. Corporation is given a budget and given limited capital, and also because the actual agents running the corporations are human beings, they are capable of perceiving ethical value. So for me, more interesting question is not whether robots will have rights or responsibilities. For me, more interesting question is, will ever build robots in that way? I mean, Google spends so much time and resources into building AlphaGo. I cannot imagine Google making it independent so that it will lead on its good life.
아, 예. 고향 지원의 이성용 판사입니다. 너무 그 새로운 시각을 제시해 주신 교수님들께 감사드리고요. 김기창 교수님께 좀 한 가지 여쭤보고 싶은데, 제가 이해한 바로는 어쨌든 그 이 드라이버한테는 책임이 없다는 것을 전제로 그 로만법의 그 덩키를 모으는 노예의 케이스가 이제 적용이 되는 것으로 제가 이해를 했는데, 혹시 아니라면 좀 사과를 드리고. 근데 만약에 그게 그 말씀이 맞다면은 이제 노예하고 이제 이 운전자하고가 이게 같이 취급이 될 수 있는지 약간 의문이 들어가지고요. 그러니까 저희 그 민법의 758조의 그 공작물 점유자 소유자 책임, 그게 혹시 만약에 적용이 된다면, 일단 점유자 드라이버가 점유자랑 연결이 된다면 그 부분이 일단 먼저 이제 과실이 있는지 없는지 그게 먼저 해결. 그러니까 우리 법제 현재의 법제상에서는 요 법이 좀 먼저 적용이 돼야 되는 것 아닌지 그런 의문이 좀 들었습니다.
The question regarding Korean Civil Code provision stipulating liabilities of a person who possesses installations, 공작물. That provision, I find it difficult to apply to autonomous vehicles. Because autonomous vehicles, in my view, does not fit the concept, the definition of installations. In my view, installations apply to buildings or other structure which does not move here and there. In my view, once an accident happens and another person is injured, that risk or that loss has to be compensated by the closest party, which is the operator, rather than the manufacturer. The discussion which tries to introduce product liability in the area of autonomous vehicles is, in my view, going to put too much burden on manufacturers, and that will basically cripple the introduction of this new technology into our society. My idea that we must reject product liability rule is to allocate risks to multiple parties who are more immediately associated with the risk itself, rather than putting everything, all the burden on the manufacturer. Now, once the operator is held liable and compensates and thus reallocate the loss, then the next question is whether operator can seek reimbursement from the manufacturer. There, yes, we can talk about product liability, which is a different issue, but there it will, the question will entirely be about whether this particular item, this particular vehicle, or that particular model meets the expected standard or not. And there, the whole question about accountability comes again. In the area of artificial intelligence, although lawyers try to maintain that the question of fault, negligence, liability should vest in human beings, that might be the dogma of lawyers. But then the reality is it would be increasingly difficult to pinpoint fault to some human agent along the line. It would be almost impossible to pinpoint any coding error or that kind of human sources of fault. So we might have to face a situation where it becomes almost impossible to pinpoint human error, but the machine did some inscrutable decisions, and then we have the risk. That's really the challenge of accountability, which we are going to have to face.
Who has some suffering rare disease, there's no the approved curing process is exists, but he or she wants some special kind of curing process that is, although that's not authorized by authority, but he wants receive that kind of cure. So that's illegal?
Under the Korean law, lawyers again have ready rules to apply in that kind of situation. We have this notion of comparative negligence or victim's consent. So for untested or still experimental treatment, the risk which occurred as a result of applying experimental remedy can be dealt with by this notion of victim's consent or victim's carelessness. So these two rules lawyers can play with for the moment. But as Professor Gasser pointed out, it is doubtful whether we can persist in applying the old rules in the new situation.
This issue of product liability is real and alive right now. There is a bill in Korean Congress right now which imposes not strict liability, but imposes burden shifting on accidents caused by artificial intelligence controlled systems. So It's like environmental lawsuit or product liability lawsuit. So if a robot causes some accident, the programmer will be responsible unless the programmer proves no negligence on his part. So the burden of shift the burden shifts from to the defendant from the plaintiff. So it's something that I thought the people in the audience should know.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.